Well, hi everyone, and welcome to the next installment in our new model series, which invites practitioners from different disciplines to discuss how their work can change the models around which society is organized. These conversations will address how we can shift power structures, socio-economic forces, and structural inequalities present in society today to give us new tools to rethink the world around us. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Manisha Berge, so I'm the head of the AA's public programs, and I'm delighted to introduce tonight's speakers, who are both perfect examples of people actively working to change the status quo through their unique forms of practice. So Rosa-Johan Uddoh is an interdisciplinary artist whose work strives towards radical self-love inspired by Black feminist practice and writing. Her practice involves performance, writing, and multimedia installation, incorporating British pop culture in how she explores places, objects, and celebrities, and their effects on self-formation. Rosa is the 2020 Stuart Hall Library resident, a lecturer in performance at Central St. Martin's in London, and co-founder of diasporic dance group DIDD. Rosa has a new book, Practice Makes Perfect, coming out in the spring next year, which is co-published with Bookworks and Focal Point Gallery. Thandi Loewenson is an architectural designer and researcher whose practice operates through design, fiction, and performance to interrogate our perceived and lived realms and to speculate on the possible worlds in our midst. Instrumentalizing both the weird and the tender, she works with communities, policymakers, artists, and architects on projects which question the world around us. Thandi is a tutor at the Royal College of Art in London, a visiting professor at the Aarhus School of Architecture, and a co-foundress of the architectural collective Breakline. Tonight, they'll present a new model for rehearsal by weaving together multiple voices, histories, narratives, sites, and events to set the stage for change to occur. In their words, we'll be locating the right site, setting the right scene, making the right props, choosing the right outfit, engaging the right backing singers, and running the right routines. Rehearsing the revolution. So with that call to arms, I'd like to welcome you both to the AA, albeit virtually, and thank you for joining us for this important and overdue series of conversations.
Thank you, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm gonna dive right in. And because on top of everything you said, I'm also extra, this is gonna be operated and deployed through multiple screens and multiple voices. This is the first time I've ever done this. So thank you all for coming on this journey with me and apologies for any inevitable mishaps, which look like beautiful mishaps, let's call them. okay, so what follows are a few thoughts on what I'm calling Black Fight, formed somewhere between Lusaka, Harare, Joburg, Dubai Airport, and London, and with the help of those who have taken off before me. You'll hear my voice, but also the voices of others, in large part the members of a tribe called Quest, Q-Tip, Ali Shaheed Muhammad, Jarobi White, and from beyond the grave, Phife Dawg too. He is not the only ghost that we will conjure tonight. I would also like to acknowledge the research of the writer Namwali Serpil and the filmmaker Kabinda Lemba, whose archival research and analysis of the Zambian space program this work pays reference to and sits alongside. In the theater of the oppressed, the activist, educator, and theater practitioner and theorist, Augusta Boal, describes the gap between the performing scenes of desired change and actually engaging in enacting such changes. Rather than simply providing catharsis or contributing to a lack of action towards change, Boal finds that popular theatrical forms which liberate the spectator into a participant in the mix and trouble the prescribed roles of authorship beyond that of a single dominant voice allow for something productively disruptive to occur. Boal writes, "Perhaps the theatre is not revolutionary in itself, but it is surely a rehearsal for the revolution. The liberated spectator, as a whole person, launches into action. No matter that the action is fictional, what matters is that it is action. There is potential in the gap which the fictional world of theatre wrenches open. As Boal describes it, in the people's theatre, the performance evokes in those who participate a desire to practice in reality the act that they have rehearsed. The practice of these theatrical forms creates a sort of uneasy sense of incompleteness that seeks fulfillment through real action. And I've been wondering about and experimenting with drawing and sharing drawings as a form of forum theatre. If we were all together, I would have put these on a table and invited us to huddle around, as illicit and dangerous as such intimate proximity sounds now. But in the absence of all of this, I've extended the forum of participants to a series of players with whom I have been able to come into contact. These are a series of characters held in the fuzzy-edged, grainy, visually noisy footage that exists of the Zambian space program, which I will come onto later. A host of graphite sticks, a roll, and then a series of sheets of paper, and the dialogue that occurs between the hand, the subjects, the surface, the matter and material, and those with whom the drawings are shared. Can this also be a forum of sorts, a space of rehearsal? So the drawings that you will see have been made with graphite, a mined mineral which is not particularly precious, quite ubiquitous, but which under high pressure and temperature turns to diamond. I'm absolutely not interested in that destruction. Left to its own devices, however, the graphite slakes off, leaving traces of encounter with everything it comes into contact with, a material always automatically giving of itself. When working with graphite, one should really wear a mask and gloves, as in its generosity, it gets everywhere. It is inhaled, ingested, and absorbed. It becomes a part of you. And as one comment on the DeviantArt message board says, you really don't want to get black lung just because you huffed a bunch of pencil dust. Graphite is the only non-metal which can conduct electricity. And in drawings, graphite becomes a conductor of ideas and energy too. But what about what graphite receives? The Ohio Carbon Bank blog tells us that the US military and nuclear energy plants use graphite for electromagnetic wave absorption, and that a lesser known property of graphite is its unique ability to absorb fast moving particles, protons and neutrons. This interesting property allows the material to absorb light, but also radio waves, microwaves, and radiation too. It is a material in constant dialogue with the very origins of the universe. Mark Fisher quotes Eric Davis in the spectacular K-Punk blog post, London After the Rave. And Davis writes, from the moment that human beings started communicating with electrical and electromagnetic signals, the ether has been a spooky place. 4 years after Samuel Morse strung up his first telegraph wire in 1844, two young girls in upstate New York kickstarted spiritualism, a massively popular occult religion which attempted to fuse science and seance. Now, you may think that this ghoulish tweaking has gone the way of the dowsing rod, but electromagnetic spiritualism is alive and well. Today, aficionados call it electronic voice phenomena, or EVP. He goes on, interestingly, one of the most important requirements for good EVP is the presence of noise, a distorted channel, interference, echo, superimposition. In other words, all of the active elements of our current hip-hop dub mixology are designed to receive these spectral messages. No wonder this stuff can put you into another world. And I put it to you that graphite bears many of the same qualities too. With its similarly spooky spectral qualities, it is a material synonymous with noise and dust. And in making a mark through the superimposition of layers and layers and layers of conductive matter on the page, an electromagnetic cosmic echo can also be observed. A Tribe Called Quest's last single, The Space Program, begins with a similar conjuring. A sample from the 1974 blaxploitation film, Willie Dynamite, in which a so-called underworld character, Bell, seeks to organize a black community against the forces of a racializing, oppressive system of control. The track begins.
I want to deal with a bigger insult, man. The heat.
It's coming down hard. We got to get
in the film, satin suits, complete with fur and fringe-lined lapels, in a kitsch explosion of a room, all gold fittings and timber cladding, in which a wildcat sleeps quietly under a lounge chair. A group of black pimps identify that unless they collectively organize to construct life otherwise, a system designed to capture, control, and extinguish the air from our lungs will always find ways to prevail. Their vision is, of course, fundamentally flawed in that the success of this alternative life is to be gained in the policing of black women's bodies and the unfair exploitation of their labor. This is a failing which the narrative arc of the film draws out as a cautionary tale for radical movements, making it an almost perfect critique of racial capitalism then and now. This moment, as one YouTube commenter posits, is probably the most important scene in Black cinema. And to me, the space program is a similarly seismic moment in Black radical cultural production. Now, space here refers to the universe, that untapped pool of asteroid resources, planets to colonize, and in which we are told a space force orbits to provide superiority and command over this dominion. Though with Biden's election, I don't know what's happened to the space force, something to keep an eye on. By implication, this is for some atmospherically over others. It is also the expanse of unknown quantity and delineation in which we find our currently embattled and enplagued planet, largely comprising a dark matter and a dark energy of which we know very little. At the end of verse 2, when Q-Tip raps,
imagine if she would really talk about this.
If you haven't got it by now, the space program refers to the impossibility of some to even survive in a system in which privatization and profit reign over production and place. Quest, go on.
Moved you out your neighborhood, did they find you a home?
Nah, we're presented with a future that looks to the galaxy for more resources, whilst talking of the sustainability of an extractive way of life, and indeed the extraction of Black life. In the last single of a 30-year repertoire of Black sound and sonic refusal, to use the terms of the scholar DJ Lene Denise, A Tribe Called Quest are clear. They call on us to build, they call on us to make.
Make something happen.
They show that the scale of the creative project required for this is none other than that of taking flight, of Black flight. At turns, the video for the space program has early Q-Tip and Phife in a spaceship, and yet for them there is no Black future in space.
What seems the poorest persons, the people forsaken, dog and Washington's, Jefferson's, Jackson's, all the captain's law, the rather leave us to the greatest water poison, deli small, mass unblackening, it's happening.
And simultaneously, we see them wandering through a desert, engaged in a strategic battle of minds with a faceless suited figure synonymous with a hegemonic white capital class. And I'm reminded of a journey of my own, similarly spent between the heavens and the ground, navigating Lusaka's illustrious and in parts overgrown Leopard's Hill Cemetery, accompanied by my good friend, taxi driver and research collaborator, Paul Mumbi. Paul and I were following a team of gravediggers, armed with spades and grass cutters, working to negotiate the paradoxical abundance of life bursting from the ground in search of the burial site of the pioneer of Zambia's independence era space program, Director General Edward Festus Mukuka Nkoloso. Now, in reflecting on the space program, again, A Tribe Called Quest know exactly what's up.
For non-conformists, one-hitter quitters. For types and types and shape figures. Let's get it together, come on, let's make it. Gotta make it,
to make it,
to make it,
to make it,
to make something happen,
to make something happen,
to make something happen.
And had been allowed to continue, Colossal Space Program was one which early Q-Tip and Phife might well have found resonance. And Colossal constructed a rigorous and inventive course of training, which included performance, physical exercise, simulations of anti-gravity, and class-based study. The program was equipped with a spacecraft and a team of specially trained astronauts and led by a Black woman, Matha Mwamba, and her deputy, Godfrey Mwango. And footage and accounts of the cadets show that engagement in Colossal's program was taken very seriously. So if we go back to Quest.
My reputation ain't glowing, reparations ain't flowing. If you find yourself stuck in
this,
you
better start growing. Unfolding against the backdrop of Zambian independence is pertinent. As Namwali Serpil has written about, and Colossal's work throughout his life was closely associated with his history of struggle for the emancipation of Black people in the region from British colonial control. Alongside the space program, in seeking to make the break from colonialism, the newly independent Zambian government undertook a series of economic and social reforms that would radically restructure relations between people, property, and the earth. And through the abolition of private property and the nationalization of the mines, the country's land and minerals were no longer matter for generating profit, but rather matter that had the means to enrich the lives and futures of the Zambian population.
We're there.
Where?
Here. A small step for mankind, but a giant step
towards
for us.
The same ends, the concurrent Zambian space program required of Black Zambians to craft a narrative in which Black people were themselves no longer seen as resources and were not only free to flourish on Earth, but could aspire to even greater heights too. That this group of Zambian astronauts never made it into orbit is neither here nor there. This was a project that was not solely concerned with leaving Earth's orbit, nor was it preoccupied with a future emancipation. Arguably, in conceiving of and constructing the program, the journey that Nkoloso sought to undertake was already successful. And fittingly, the motto of the program is given in the present indefinite tense. Wherever fate and human glory are found, we are always there. This emancipation is ubiquitous. It is occurring wherever. It has occurred and will continue unceasingly into the future. The Zambian astronauts are always already there. So what follows is an incomplete taxonomy of flight, drawings from footage of rehearsals. So the first are the oil drums. And Nkoloso tells a press conference, I'm getting them acclimatized to space travel by placing them in my space capsule every day. It is a 40-gallon oil drum in which they sit and then roll down the side of a hill. This gives them the feeling of free-falling through space. I watch in the footage as a team waits to catch the barrel at the base of the hill. The first attempt is unsuccessful, but unfortunately, the second attempt brings the barrel to a halt. It looks terrifying, but the astronaut emerges, all smiles and triumphant. And next we have the swing. Despite Nkoloso's terrifying description, he writes, I also make them swing from the end of a long rope. When they reach the highest point, I cut the rope, and this produces the feeling of freefall. The footage we have of the swings show exercises which instead appear to be hugely entertaining. There is no slicing of the rope here and seemingly no fear of it either. And I wonder if this is Martha, the lead astronaut, as she rushes towards us, filling the frame. The helmets. And Colossal's helmet appears to be the most advanced. Netting covers a sturdy metal bowl with a thick strap fixing it under his chin. Footage shows that other astronauts are wearing helmets too, smartly wandering through the backgrounds of shots and wearing them during the most vigorous of training exercises. And then we have the books. Rummaging is not a dignified act. It implies a state of chaos, a disorderly approach to sorting through mess. One journalist at the time writes disparagingly of Nkoloso, rummaging through this battered briefcase, he pulls out a space comic book. I get a lot of ideas from this, Nkoloso says. So have many American and Russian scientists. And I find that before I even encounter the book, I have been conditioned to view Nkoloso and the program in a particular light. This comic can only be something to be ridiculed. And yet the ITN footage shows a book that looks significantly more like an academic book with diagrams, text, photographs. I realize that perhaps yet again, Nkoloso may be one step ahead. The books here could be comic books or encyclopedias. What matters more is the work of the book as a prop, that we are seen to consult a particular form of communicating and consolidating knowledge. If the journey one seeks to undertake is epistemic, a barrel can be a space capsule, and even a comic book can hold the technology to activate that capsule. So key to the program is, of course, the Director General. And throughout, Nkoloso is a striking figure. When I first see him in a photograph alongside an article he has authored, he is in full military uniform with an impressive array of badges and decorations, wearing his helmet and a broad smile. Footage of him at the academy shows him in a crisp white shirt and with a tie which flops over a billowing cape, only serving to accentuate the otherworldliness of the garment. It would be reductive to describe his appearance as merely reflective of the activities that he was engaged in. And rather, I find that this crafted presence was a constitutive part of his project and their political agenda, bringing together attire and influences from a range of sources and constructing an entirely new emancipatory being from its components, the right props for the right performance, for the right rehearsal. And of course, what is a space program without a team of astronauts? The astronauts' delight in lifting their fellow cadet from a barrel, as grueling as as it was. His silk shirt does not appear to have been damaged at all. His arms were raised so that he could be lifted out of the barrel. Now that he is up, they remain lifted. Next to him, two astronauts wear smart blazers of a fabric that appears soft, with a trim that catches the light. It is the same fabric and trim as the majestic cape of the Director General. The Standard. Nkoloso holds the standard as he leads the group in a single file circuit around the hill on which we'd earlier witnessed the hair-raising barrel roll. When the cadets sit on the ground, legs outstretched, vigorously shaking their arms, one stands sentry at the back, holding the standard high as another astronaut takes his turn on the swing. The standard again is held up, the golden bird it bears reminiscent of the new country's national symbol, the Eagle of Liberty. And throughout all of this vigorous physical action is the abandoned farmhouse. The interviewer who's capturing all of this footage casually describes the venue for the Zambian space program as an abandoned farmhouse. But there is no footage shot inside the house itself, and journalist accounts either describe activity which has taken place outside or in other sites within the city. The abandoned farmhouse has then become something of a ghost of the Zambian space program, a white presence which is never properly encountered or addressed, and secondary to the true action. On independence, and a significant number of the white population left Zambia for South Africa, and I wonder if the house is an artifact rather of white flight, its grounds repurposed for the very opposite. So onto the rocket. The American journalist Arthur Hopp generously gives us one of the most exacting descriptions of a rocket launch. I quote, "Mwango, in a khaki uniform and combat helmet, lay stiffly on the ground as the oil drum was tilted over onto its side. If he felt any anxiety, then he didn't show it. Then, on Colossal's orders, Mwango and fellow astronauts, one hampered by a spear, stuffed him into the oil drum feet first. A-OK, said Nkoloso anxiously, thumping the steel on the side of the space capsule. A-OK, came the game if muffled reply. Blast off, cried Nkoloso, giving the space capsule a shove with his foot. All systems go. Mwango brought the space capsule to its land against the blue gum tree completely unassisted. Man, what a ride, he said. Nkoloso nodded his head approvingly. That is what the astronauts always say, he explained. The limitations of a barrel for leaving the Earth's atmosphere are never raised by Nkoloso or any of his team. Instead, the exercise is considered, in Colossal's own words, an unqualified success. And what is a rocket without its propulsion systems? There were several propulsion systems proposed for the rocket. The first, planned for Independence Day but vetoed by the authorities, comprised of several cases of dynamite stuck beneath a capsule to be set alight at the peak of ceremonies. The Mukwa and Mulolo systems, which followed, were developed from local technologies, the Mukwa involving a catapult system built using wood from local Mukwa trees, and the Mulolo system involving ropes tied to tall trees from which astronauts would be swung slowly out into space. The last reported system under investigation is cryptically only titled Turbulent Propulsion. Nkoloso would only reveal the name of the system to conceal the details from the Russians and the Americans as a matter of national prestige. And Colossal's parting words to Hopp, one of the journalists, spoke to his concerns about the Russians and the Americans. What they can do, we can also do. At this point, the Cold War space race was underway, yet to put a person on the moon. And in this context, Colossal's words rung true. If America and Russia could work towards a moonshot, so too could Zambia. And lastly, onto the lead astronauts. Matha Mwamba. Little is known of Matha, despite her prestigious position as the lead astronaut of the program, destined to go to the moon and then on to Mars. And Colossal's son describes how the Zambian space program was open to those who could complete the training, and women excelled. In footage of the program, I have seen two women. I think they're both shown here, but I cannot be sure if either is her. She captured the imagination of the American and British journalists who described her as the sister of the heavens and Zambia's number one space girl, but yet who didn't afford her the opportunity to speak for herself within their articles. By contrast, We have photographs of Godfrey Mwango, detailed descriptions of him and even his own voice, described as Nkoloso's closest confidant and bodyguard. And when Mwango asserts with a grin that I am ready for the Mars flight now, Nkoloso corrects him. That trip is Martha's to take. His grin vanishes, we later read. A note of foreboding in the Miami News after Zambian independence suggests that Mwango and Mwamba's relationship would ultimately scupper their space plans. And Nkoloso is distressed. And I quote, there's too much lovemaking going on. I've had troubles with my spaceman and spacewoman. They won't concentrate on spaceflight. There's too much lovemaking when they should be studying the moon. A year later, Martha Mwamba was pregnant and, according to Nkoloso, had been talked out of continuing the Zambian space program by her parents. In Black Holes, A Brief History of Time, M. Norbisi Philip gives us a number of rearticulated, reconfigured cosmic definitions of the universe. Philip writes, space-time, the four-dimensional space whose points are events. You cannot talk about space as it relates to Black people, to African people, without talking about movement or moving through space. And once you talk about moving through space as it relates to Africans, then you must confront the forces that prohibit or restrict that moving. And now seems a good time to reflect back on Quest. We have been watching the supermassive black hole at the center of the dark forest of our galaxy for over 20 years. Footage of this vigil is both largely uneventful and full of action. It is characterized by a multitude of presence, an oily, fuzzy-edged blackness in which bright white dots of varying sizes hover and surge erratically, silent. Simultaneously, nothing really happens. It is something of a paradox to be watching a black hole at all, in a landscape in which sight is dependent on time travel and listening in to faint radio frequency signals. Our tools, bodily and scientific, can only hint at the complexity. Here, where the force of gravity is so strong that it draws everything into an untold depth of being, where there is nothing to see at all. Instead, we observe its event horizon, a point of no return from which an object passing through will be sucked in. At 10 million degrees centigrade, the horizon is the hole's hottest and brightest feature. Without it, we would not know it was even there. A moment in the darkness where feverish, luminous action precipitates absence, and in so doing, validates a presence which cannot be seen. The absence implied by hole is also a misnomer. This is a blackness quite unlike that oil slick vacuum of space which fills the telescope. This is a darkness which hoovers up. It eats planets. It swallows stars by incrementally slurping in their matter and eliciting a flare of light in their wake. It inhales insatiably and in return spews light back at us at seemingly impossible speeds of superluminal motion. This is a weighty hole, a hulking hole. A spectacular force of black gravity, which holds an enormous quantity of light. When Questlove extended Einstein's beautifully titled theory of quantum entanglement, spooky action at a distance, that is the phenomenon in which two remote objects can be almost inexplicably conjoined, such that they can be moved, altered, affected, without ever physically touching. He knew, as Nkoloso has taught me, that blackness too exists in a spooky condition, simultaneously bodily, geological, planetary, cosmic conjoined. Questlove says, Einstein was talking about physics, of course, but to me he's talking about something closer to home, the way that other people affect you, the way that your life is entangled in theirs, whether or not there's a clear line of connection. And I think back to Quest here now too.
Sit and wonder sometimes, I read the paper every day. All these happenings are singular, just happen different ways.
Paul and I quickly find that you have to be careful when moving through the graveyard. In some cases, caskets have been exhumed from these graves and holes remain where liberators have finally made it back home to countries of which only dreams existed when they had died. Zimbabwe, Mozambique, Malawi, South Africa, to name a few.
Dreams of those countries exist again today, of governments able to assert, and that assert, relations between people and between people and earth beyond the profit motive, and in which Black presence and futurity is a project in the making and not in retreat. For those of us concerned with space, the journey continues. A keen understanding of quantum mechanics should give us pause. While you may not be able to see the enormity of a growing body of light and energy, that does not mean you cannot witness its effects or comprehend the veracity of its presence. Perhaps through the careful study of black holes, shifting between light, years, forward and back, remaining attentive to the matter which bursts forth and the gravity of the emancipatory ideas which draw us closer, we might just find the strength to take flight, to make something happen, to get it together forever.
Let's make something happen. Let's make something happen. Gotta get it together for brothers. Gotta get it together for sisters. For mothers and fathers and dead niggas. For non-conformers, one-hitter quitters. For types and types and chain figures. Make, make, make. Let's make something happen. Let's make something happen. Let's make something happen. Let's make something happen. Gotta get it together forever. Gotta get it together for brothers. Gotta get it together for sisters.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Thandi. That was really beautiful.
Thanks. It's wonderful to be in conversation with you, and I'm super excited for what you're about to share.
Yeah, well, no, I'm really excited as well. I guess maybe I'll show you some stuff and then we can chat about it. I have so many thoughts after that. Thank you so much. My name's Rosa-Johan Uddoh. I'm a interdisciplinary artist. And I work mainly a lot with performance, and for the last few years, I've been really interested in how performance affects our self-formation. So I'm interested in performance in terms of everyday performances that we might do, but I'm also interested in performances in popular culture that are enacted by celebrities or role models, and how those performances also then inform the way in which we ourselves perform. So I've looked at lots of different characters in British popular culture to see how they might inform a Black and British identity. The work that I'm going to show you today kind of came after a really long period of research into the newsreader Moira Stuart. Moira Stuart was the first Black newsreader in the UK, and she first came onto our television screens in 1981. And she stayed there for about 30 years. So her presenting with the news was really formative for me as a child, and I'm sure many other people's lives would have been touched by the face of Moira Stuart presenting the national news every evening. But just to go back to when Moira first started to present the news, Moira Stuart first came on TV presenting the news in April of 1981, which is really shortly months after the one of the most famous Brixton riots. Those riots were sparked off by the killing of Cherry Ghost in her home in Brixton. And so I think that gives you, and also subsequently, the unreported death of 13 young Black teenagers in a fire in New Cross. It subsequently became known as the New Cross Massacre. After that massacre, that massacre was famously not reported on the news. So I think it's really interesting that just months after these really defining events, that's when and defining events for race relations that really hinge upon and expose society's lack of respect for Black women and girls, that this is when Moira Stuart appeared on our TV screens. In particular, I was interested in looking and honouring the labour of Moira's performances, which I consider not as automatic, but as a particular labour and particularly a feat for her to be able to present herself as a trustworthy Black woman in a time when many Black women were not welcome in many people's homes in the UK. How did she perform herself not only as a newsreader, but as a trustworthy Black woman who was believable and who is the face of the British nation as she was presenting news on the BBC? So I spent a lot of time watching her news broadcasts, paying particular attention to her gestures, the way she tilts her head, the way she always raises her eyebrows slightly to the right. Looking at all of these looking at the way that her face is, she manages to repeat this choreographed facial expression almost identically every single broadcast for the 30 years in which she's stayed on TV. All of this is a particular labour of performance, a performance of impartiality. So these works that I'm about to show you kind of come out of my research into Moira Stuart. And I was, I think I'll maybe just play them to you now. I'm going to share my screen and play them, but I'm also going to drop them in the chat, because I know that sometimes when you're sharing screens, there can be a bit of interference. So the first video I'm going to show these are from a, this is a series called Performing Witness. It's a 3-part series. So I'm going to show you the first part and then go on from there. So you should see the link there to the first video.
Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Here's the second video. This is Performing Witness 2, news. That's the second video. I'm going to share it with you now as well.
Good evening. In the the second of our election blind date series, a restructuring plan is introduced, written by the Conservatives and Channel 4 over last night's leaders' climate debate. You're watching Afternoon Live. More than 140 children's charities and drag performer Courtney Axe at the energy giant Empower. Charities say three quarters of Empower's workforce edges closer to an Arsenal exit. But Empower says to benefit from the lucrative after 78 games in charge is what living with cancer is really like. I'll be looking at how successful it's been and what you can do to be a part of it. Turmoil at Arsenal, Gavin. It's Friday. 4,500 jobs to go. A manuscript written by Elizabeth I is discovered. And between Channel 4, the Conservatives in the Europa League and Scotland Yard, up to 4,500 jobs are at risk. The unions have described it as a cruel blow. In over 25 years, see you later. The benefits of Brexit, there are just a few hours left. Claims of a paedophile ring, frozen out. The former South Yorkshire police chief is cleared of manslaughter for the next few days, promising it'll be easier. Look forward to that, Gavin, praising the monarchy. Also this lunchtime, tonight, we'll be analysing the reasons for the job cuts on Monday, leaving millions of children scarred for life. The next UN climate conference sets out what he says are the benefits of Brexit. A 42-page manuscript and Charlie State. Hillsborough victims pay former MP. And Arsenal sacks its manager, Elizabeth I. Tonight. And a cold but bright agree on anything beyond their shared love of sequins and big jewellery. Tonight. Members of the public stepped in and wrestled. Tens of thousands pulling him to the ground. The Magna Carta charged with complicity. Country is in turmoil.
Tonight.
The suspect was wearing the Prime Minister.
Tonight.
He had the disease since 2011.
Tonight.
He has died at the scene.
Tonight.
He has declined to take part.
Tonight.
Early release.
Tonight.
Hot but bright.
Tonight.
There is no further danger to the public. Tonight.
Walk out of class.
Look forward to that, Gavin.
Walk out of school.
Across the world.
We'll hear from the family.
Gavin has the details.
Half a million compensation.
The number is increasing dramatically.
Thousands of students.
Across the world.
Tonight.
Hello, David Duckinfield. I'm Rebecca Jones.
Tonight.
I'm Joanna Goslin.
Tonight.
I'm Elizabeth I with Naga Munchetty.
Tonight.
One of these women with messy handwriting.
Tonight.
I'll be bringing you all the latest this morning.
Whoa!
And the final video. Let's put it in the chat for you. Yeah, so this is Performance Witness 3, Private Life Drama. On the screen.
Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. out. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Cinema of your theatrics, your acting's a drag. It's okay on TV, but you can turn it off. Your broadcast is a tragedy, but it's not my concern. I am very superficial. I hate everything official. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. 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 Your diversity gestures only bore me to death. You've made a desperate appeal. Now save your breath. Attachment to obligation, that's so wet. And your sex life complications are not my fascination. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Private life drama, baby, leave me out. You ask my advice. I say, relinquish the means of production. But you're still clinging to an institution you deplore. And now you want to use me for emotional blackmail. I just feel pity when you lie, contempt when you cry. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out. Your private life drama, baby, leave me out.
Yeah, so there you have it. Performing witness.
Thank you both. I think two really different but equally incredible presentations of some amazing work. And yeah, there's, I think, a lot to discuss. I don't know whether you want to start the conversation and then I'll follow up with some questions. But just so our audience knows, if you have questions for Rosa and Thandi, if you use the raise hand thing in the participants tab, I can unmute you to ask your question. And otherwise you can post things in the chat and we can ask it on your behalf. But yeah, I guess also to prevent us from feeling like we're just talking into a void, if you don't mind turning on your camera for this portion of the evening, that would be great. Yeah, so I don't want to interfere in both of you getting to have a conversation, and then maybe I'll jump in with some questions in a bit.
One thing that I really loved about the oh, thank you so much, Rosa. I love those pieces. I turned my camera off because I was dancing. I didn't want everyone to see. but I think there's something really nice in these, the way in which women, Black women in particular, figure in both of our work, and the kind of the process of kind of producing the work and the intimacy of the relation that you can occur with these figures. I don't want to say with them necessarily, but with this the performed figure that we kind of encounter, which is super nice. And when I was doing these drawings and throughout this process of engaging with this work, for me, Martha has been this really difficult figure to get to grips with, just because so little is written about her. And she very rarely gets her, well, I think there's only one quote that I found of her in her own voice. And so it's like always been looking in footage and trying to kind of see this person and trying to put weight or matter behind this person. And then it was only in the process of drawing that I actually started to like find her in the background of shots that I didn't even see her in before, and like started to see all these idiosyncrasies and these qualities of her character, which are really quite amazing. And I was thinking about that when you were talking about kind of obsessively watching Moira's videos over and over again, like the one eyebrow, amazing. it would be great if you could talk more about that and your process of getting to know this person.
I think you're so right. I think it's really, because so little is often known about people, about Black women, even those who are in the public light. Moira Stuart famously has only ever given like three interviews, and she doesn't really talk much about her personal life. And I think that's because I guess she has this expectation of impartiality. So she's not afforded, she can't have too much personality, and that was in one side. But then if you pay really close attention, you see, you know, the outfits, the wigs, the very act of her even being there at all actually speaks volumes about her. And it's really, I think it's really important for us as Black women and people who are affected by representation, by the representation of others like us, that we pay close attention to these figures and see what's been missed, because often it's a lot.
Yeah. And I don't know about you, but I often hear this, and I think I've said this as well, but like, oh, we don't have role models. We need to see women in these roles. And that's, I think that's true to an extent, but there's also a project of kind of actually going through and honoring and giving time and spending time with those women who have gone already, and kind of trying to flesh out their lives a bit more as well.
Yeah, exactly. Because I think that when you do that, you allow, it's much more possible then to learn from them. Like, I think that as you see in your work, like through like even your studying of the fragments of the archive in which she exists, it's, you then, we begin to build up a picture of her life, or at least we build up a picture of her life, or the people around her, her family telling her to stop the space program, her co-workers, her boss, like all of these people who are around her. And then that kind of allows you also to then project, I think that what that means is that you then project your own predicament onto them. And I think, although there's, although historically speaking, that might not be like the scholarly thing to do, I do think it does have a power, because it exposes, it allows us to know ourselves as Black women now better. Like that looking back, even if it won't be historically accurate, it's kind of tells us something about the present, I think.
Totally. I mean, I think I don't know about historical accuracy. So this is probably in terrible form, but in the RCA lecture series. We have an event later on, which is Ariella Aisha Azulay. That's at 8 p.m. Don't worry, it's well after this one. But so I've been thinking a lot about Ariella's work and this idea of potential history. And I was thinking then also about like speculative history inside your Hartman and how she talks about like these archives are inherently violent, right? And so how do we engage with them without reproducing those violences? And for her, and I think in many ways in both of our work as well, the speculative or that placing of oneself into the archive, like physically, whether it be through the act of embodying or drawing as a process, allows for that redress, that necessary redress to occur in order for another story to emerge out of it.
Yeah, and I think also as a kind of gesture to taking control over the ways in which we are represented. And, you know, like I think, you know, through looking at figures such as Moira Stuart, I realise how, you know, I've begun to question who is presented as a role model, who's presented as a successful Black woman in mainstream media, and how has the ways in which these characters have been presented like affected, you know, what we value, what we prize. I'm interested in the consequences of tokenization. So one thing that's, you know, a lot of these people who are role models, you look at like the figures that you learn about in Black history, the few Black women you learn about in school in this country, look at Rosa Parks. She's held up because she's one woman on her own on a bus who refuses to sit at the back. Then if you look at, yeah, completely different, you look at Moira Stuart, she's held up because she's the first Black woman, and for a long time she was the only Black woman on TV, and especially the only one who was in a position of authority, in the position of national backing. And I think when I actually analyze that and look more into their lives, you think, wow, is that actually what, you know, it's not, is that actually what we want to replicate in our own lives? Like being the only one in an institution, being the only one in a certain position, that's what we're telling people, young people, to like become, and then you find yourself like replicate, caught in the same loops, caught in same, oh, you're the first this, oh, you're struggling against an institution, you're there, you've made it, but it's difficult. And it's, you caught yourself in the same trap over and over again, because the fact is that those people's lives and how they're, like, you know, we talk about these figures in isolation rather than how their lived experience, even if they're famous names, we don't know how they lived their lives, and we don't know what it was actually like.
Maybe I can jump in there just because I thought what was really striking about both was actually how through the making of your work you revealed so much more about these figures than maybe even they were aware of at the time. And I know that the title is it's a new model for rehearsal, but I think there's a degree of revealing in, I mean, Thandi, you said it in like through drawing, you kind of revealed Matha in a way that she hadn't been documented in the existing archive. And I think, Rosa, when you spoke about this kind of incompleteness, I mean, it's interesting to think, I mean, obviously you said that Moira was aware of her role and maybe of of ways she could insert, I guess, like the revolution through her choice of outfits and her wigs and things like that. But I wonder how conscious some of that was and how unconscious some of that was, and how your work kind of brings that more to the surface, or as you say, like provides us with ways to reread the present or rethink that. But I also just wanted to pick up on, I really liked what you said just now about the fact that we're constantly celebrating the individual, and this, that in order to make change happen, we have to sacrifice things. We have to be the lone pioneer fighting for this. And it makes it seem so hard. And obviously there is a struggle and it is hard, but why can't it be collective? And I was curious as to like how making, for each of you, how making work helps you kind of think through that or present an alternative.
Yeah, I mean, okay, I'll jump in. Sorry, my internet is a little shonky, but I hope you can hear me.
Yeah,
I think this, maybe if I could touch a bit on the idea of collective thinking and process, and maybe also open up another avenue as well, which is about working with popular culture and what that does to the work. As I think you're like, it's a myth that we produce work in isolation completely. There is this single voice that generates this never before seen project, and it's like beautiful. And I think one thing that I'm kind of really keen to hold when I approach work is that this is kind of always already collectively produced, whether it's in this track that I'm listening to and the ideas that are kind of being absorbed through that, or in like the YouTube comment that you see underneath it, or down to, you know, much more finer grain about these, this kind of very close engagement that you get with a series of characters or sites or, but of course, I mean, that I think this is has been a super interesting process for me, this piece, because like, Rosa, you and I, we had another event at the beginning of lockdown, I think, and that was the first sort of incarnation of ideas around this piece. And then it's been sort of rewritten and reperformed and rethought about, and conversations and sharing of the work and the conversations that occur when you do that are also kind of part of that process, which is really counter to the logic of the crit, right? In the way that we're taught in architecture school. And it, maybe there's something in that, in like a reconceiving of the way in which we share the work, and that being a generative process rather than one in which you open yourself up to be kind of poked and prodded. Maybe I'll...
Yeah, and also something that makes it like part of the work as well, like part makes that the conversation part of the work, I think. That's really important. Like, I think I'm really interested. I mean, I'm really interested in the idea of showing unfinished work. I think there's power in work not being polished and not being completely high production value, which kind of goes back to this point about like about glorification of individuals and how their lives must be difficult in order for our lives to be somewhat better. If you're glorifying individual lonely people, then you are like, yeah, you're making it. It just doesn't seem as possible. Like, I think it's something in opening things up to the collective, saying that you can do things together, that makes change seem much more possible. And I think that also goes for, yeah, presenting work which is not completed, that needs others to think it with.
Yeah, I mean, maybe picking up also on the role of pop culture that both of you kind of use in your work. I mean, I'm quite fascinated. I've been fascinated by this for a while, that in terms of like a revolution or change, I think what can like slower cultures like architecture maybe learn from how pop culture like really captures like what's happening at a certain moment in time and gives people a voice and an ability to communicate and a way to capture a culture that has been kind of oppressed or limited by a dominant power. And I think what I find so magical about pop culture is it finds a way to still emerge and to create this sense of the collective. And I think it's just also really interesting that both of you use it in very different ways in your work. And I was just curious as to what slower forms of culture could learn from pop culture as a way to decolonize, to fight back, to find a voice sometimes when you don't have one.
I think for me, performance, and when I talk about performance, I guess for me it's performance art, but also, yeah, it could be more popular forms. It has the, what really excited me about why I kind of made a change and moved away from architecture with a capital A and more towards performance was because I was excited by the fact that I could kind of do it myself, the idea that my body was enough, that was really, I mean, that sounds kind of contradictory to what I said before about the collective, but I guess it's more this feeling, when I say do it myself, it's more this feeling that I was enough and that then I could kind of get other people on board too. And there wasn't a need for me to do, to get loads of money to make a big project. We could do it. It seemed feasible. And that has been really exciting to me in terms of thinking about how you can reconfigure space, how you can basically do architecture in a really fast and participatory and fun way. In these videos I was really interested in how within the space and time of within the space of the camera frame and the time of a pop song you can kind of flip a power relation on its head, and how you might make an architectural space that was designed to impress and overwhelm and to say elite culture and to say high culture and to exclude Black women, quite frankly, how you might make that work, how I might make it work for myself with the help of my friends. So I think for me, pop culture in that way is really exciting because this song exists now, the video exists now, and even when I'm having a bit of a rubbish time, the fact is that once I own that staircase and it's on camera.
There's this great Zimbabwean writer, Moze Chikavera, who's written this book around the role of sound in the liberation struggle and music in the liberation struggle. And he was giving this talk at the beginning of lockdown version one. And he was talking about how before independence, when he was a kid, he just used to cycle into these really rich white neighborhoods and just make a lot of noise. it was just this really amazing, disruptive, and it was that's how you annoy rich white people, is you go in and be deviant in their environments, right? And or be deviant in the ways that they're through their lens. But it's also so associated with this mischievousness, this joy, this crafting of a space around you that is completely otherwise and completely has this other logic to it. And I think for me, that's also, and I see that so much in your work, Rosa, that's just so happening when you come down that staircase. And I think that's part of the way that particularly sound, I think, is working in both of our works. that it offers the space for this construction of another world, but also one that conflicts and butts up against this so-called dominant order, and shows that within this landscape, within this environment, it can be completely otherwise. And I see Rue here as well, who I'm sure has a lot to say about that much more eloquently than me.
Yeah, I mean, maybe before we open it up to questions, and I hope everyone has lots of questions, I wanted to just maybe get you both to speak a bit about the rehearsal, just because I think in the same way that maybe pop culture, people don't give it the credit that it deserves, that the power of music, the power of people coming together can often pass under the radar and create a revolution under, you know, people's noses. And so I was just curious, in the same way that, you know, people prioritize the individual, they often prioritize the main event. And so what's the power of the rehearsal for each of you?
So I wanted to, yeah, I was just thinking about, yeah, kind of the first part, just thinking again, still about pop culture and the importance of it. Sorry, I'm just going to talk about that again. but it is connected, because I just really want to underline, like, yeah, just like, it just hit me when you were talking about how people, yeah, like, might kind of not think that popular culture is that important to architecture, or that vital. And I just want to point out, so my work is, and I think Thandi's work too, is really, you know, fundamentally concerned with an exploration of Black subjectivity and its possibilities, and, you know, what it means to be a Black person moving through post-colonial space in this day and age, and what it has meant historically. And sadly, as Thandi has pointed out, many that information does not exist about this in archives. Like, there is a striking absence, a silence, if we literally talk about sound. And I think, but where there isn't a silence, so let's look at the places where Black people do feature, it has historically been performance, right? That is the one field. And when I say performance, I mean, be that musical performance, sport performance, especially those two, that has been a place where Black people have been allowed to be overrepresented in some cases. You look at the football teams of most European countries today, you look at them historically, you look at Black singers and their relative status and compared to Black people of the same countries, for example, in America, like during Jim Crow, etc. This is a really long history, and that has a particular function, right? There's particular reasons why state structures, why Western institutional structures allow Black people to be seen as performers, and performers in only very, very specific formats. And so I think when it comes, and we even see that in popular culture today, Black people are still very much associated with performance. So I think when it comes to making work about performance, when it comes to analysis, this is really, really important to look at performance to understand any, if we're going to understand in any way, Black life in the city today, because those are the places that we can mine, but also those are the places that we must also critique, because they're so, that narrative of Black people and performers is simply so dominant. So yeah, I think if coming to this idea of rehearsal, like coming to this idea of, like, it feels very important to me to expose the idea that Black people aren't natural performers, that it's important to rehearse, that we rehearse. and that also the idea that that popular culture is constructed. And I think that's really linked to the idea of rehearsal. It's designed.
I'm realizing that I think I come at it from a number of different angles. And one of them, and thank you so much for saying that, Rosa, because I'm just realizing something about the archive of this space program that I hadn't appreciated before, which is, and I didn't mention before, but that my recounting of it is completely different to what you will find if you go and look in the archive, right? there is overt racism in the archive in the matter that is written about the Samian space program. And I realize now that they are cast as performers and as animals, performing animals as well in many cases. And the entirety of the way in which it's written about is for the humor and consumption of a white Western audience, right? So that's extant. And so part of this project has been to try and tease out what are the elements of performance that are at play there that operate with a different logic, right? And why and how is that? I mean, we know why and how that archive exists, but what possibly can exist otherwise? And why and how do we read that? And what's its significance for us today? As you say, completely, Rosa. And then the other current that occurs in this work, and I was thinking about Chris Abani, his TED talk, actually, full disclosure. And he says, he's talking about African narratives. And he says, like, look, African narratives in the West proliferate. I'm much more interested in the stories that we tell about ourselves. And along those lines, one of my kind of infatuations for the last maybe 10 years, maybe probably more, has been a kind of grappling with the project and the rhetoric around the liberation movement, right? So coming from a completely different perspective, growing up in Zimbabwe and working in Zambia, there is this moment in which we are told liberation occurred, right? And yet we know that that struggles are ongoing. And so I think part of this work has also been about trying to see liberation as an ongoing project, as a project in rehearsal, not a performance, not a bygone performance, and trying to find a way of engaging with the liberation project. I sometimes describe it as thinking about the unspent fuel of the liberation project. What ideas remain for us to engage with? What is useful for us now? And how can we engage with some of the amazing stuff that happened at that time and use it to inform how we might recraft life today?
I think recrafting is really the word, because I know that when we were like first thinking about, we found it really difficult to think about what would be our new model, like for this talk. So we had to, we're given, you know, a new model for... And we had to say what this talk today was gonna provide in that sense. And we really struggled, and I think because of the idea of generating how the idea of newness is something that's quite
and also the certitude of it, right? Like, this is exactly. It.
Yeah, exactly. It was a real existential, like, well, yeah. And again, through conversation, we got to say that, okay, the only thing that we could possibly say that we were talking about that might be new would be a new rehearsal, which would already imply that this was not the final event and nor was this the first. Thinking about, you know, I'd actually recently listened to this podcast, and I think it's on the Funambulist. They had this great series called A Moment of Pure Decolonization, or something like that. Just getting people to focus on just like, yeah, for one moment when they felt they saw decolonization happen, or they felt something shift. Which again, I think focusing on that moment as opposed to like the finished whole is again a similar idea. And I think it's Ruth Wilson Gilmore who's talking and said that we have to stop reciting and start rehearsing. Mm-hmm. And she's talking about that in relation to the words of Stuart Hall, who's like the father of cultural theory, and thinking about how instead of just reading Stuart Hall so that we can say we know about cultural theory, we know about the importance of popular culture, instead reading it with the hope of an action that comes afterwards, an action afterwards will be necessary, that this isn't the final project, that this is just the rehearsal, and that is an exciting prospect rather than the lack.
Exactly. I mean, I think I think the lecture series and the requests to speakers to suggest a new model is really just to shift away from like kind of the status quo, but not to suggest it's the first time. But I think it's a really great reflection on how we need to read that. And I think it's been really useful actually to hear this, hear the process you went through to determine your title.
Yeah, it's not a criticism. It was like great to do that because it really challenged us. And I think it really, like you say, it gives an impetus on like, okay, moving, which is again, like moving is, flying or descending.
Yeah. I could probably keep asking you both questions all night, so I want to see if anyone in the audience wants to ask a question or make a comment or enter the conversation. If you can't raise your hand, just wave at me and I'll unmute you. One sec.
Hey.
Hello.
Hi, both. I always find it impossible.
Hi, Roo.
Hi. Thanks for such an amazing two presentations. I found them incredibly provocative for lots and lots of different reasons. But I also sort of slightly couldn't resist that little poke, Thandi. so I thought that, I don't know how related this is to how you work in an archive, but I work in archives a lot and I often work in archives that are sort of, I don't really know how to sort of phrase it, but they're sort of undisciplined archives, maybe is like a good way of phrasing it. Like they sort of merge lots of different sort of aspects together. And I'm often sort of trying to almost rehearse my own actions within an archive. And so I wondered like to what extent your idea of rehearsal actually sort of extends to when you're physically in an archive, I suppose, to once it's like how you're rehearsing the research that might come or you're rehearsing sort of the product that's on the way and how, I don't know. So that was something that I was thinking about. But then also in relation to sound, I don't know so much about specifically Black female newsreaders, but I've done a lot of digging around in the British Library Archive, Broadcast Archive, about female voices in particular. And there's this really interesting thing that happens where male newsreaders are named, but female newsreaders are just marked as unnamed female voice for a really, really long time. And it's like an official sort of classification in the sound archive at the British Library. And like I say, like I haven't looked into this in a sort of a more detailed way yet, but I wonder if it might be something that you found interesting, Rosa, or, but also from this sort of point of view of like how we sort of write people out of spaces and subjects and in this really sort of aggressive way. So that was like two things I had, was just about this rehearsing within the archive as a site in itself, and then also this sort of literal silencing of women within the archive, within the news broadcast context.
That's crazy about the the newsreader, the female newsreaders. It kind of undermines it as well. If you don't give a name to it, it kind of undermines what they're saying, even though I guess it's all from the same auto cue sheet. Wow. I have to think about that. That's really interesting.
It's just so classic though, isn't it? They're not even very inventive. I mean, I'm quite amazed. I find it quite shocking that Martha's the one who was meant to go to space. Like she's the one, and yet there's so little about her. It's a failing of the project, but it's also so telling, right? About exactly this, the way in which people are written out and the violence of that because of its lingering long extent and long effect as well. Which I think was quite interesting in terms of your first comment about the rehearsing within the archive. And I think there's some, I mean, I guess in the, like, for me anyway, I've been working with this material for a while, and I think I'm only just now finding a way to figure out how to contend with Martha's absence and what that means and what kind of work emerges as a result of that. But that's through, like, engaging with this stuff and working with this stuff for years. So I think there is definitely something, as you say, about spending time with material and sharing it and speaking it and finding another way to come at it and perhaps thinking of those as rehearsals in themselves. And I completely agree with you, Rosa, when you describe the performativity of a figure like Moira Stuart. And I think there is performativity too when you're doing research and you're called to speak of that work as well. And depending on the different contexts in which you speak, the performance is different, right? And that does something different to the work too, or it allows for more or less development of different aspects and of your own development, your own thinking as well. Touches on a point you mentioned earlier.
Hello. I wanted to ask Rosa, this is sort of similar to what Rue was talking about female newsreaders. They usually, when there's two, they sit on the left of the male, and apparently that's like a, or right, I don't know, but that's like the less important position or something of power. But then in your videos, you're always on the side where the man would sit. Or, I guess, is that like an active, like, did you do that on purpose?
No, I didn't. But I do believe that it must have been subconscious. Because I guess that's the thing, isn't it? When you reperform, you kind of replicate what you've already seen, or you accidentally step into something you've seen, or you rectify what you've already seen. It's like, yeah, that's really interesting. I didn't know that. Thank you.
I'm impressed with how everyone has forensically analyzed news footage. I mean, Rosa first with the
you need
eyebrow.
To form a group.
Yeah, I think this is like a collective in the making. Other questions from anyone in the audience? Maybe in the meantime, I guess ask a bit more. I mean, I think the question of the incomplete archive or the retelling of a story, or as you were saying earlier, Rosa, I guess the re-performance, like where you start to insert new narratives, or, I mean, I think we were talking about, like, you know, what needs to be historical versus does that even matter at the beginning of the conversation? And yeah, I think there's a whole, I don't know, in both of your work, I was really interested in how it was re-performed or retold, and how, I'm trying to figure out the right way to phrase this, but like, I guess how important it is that the audience understands all the nuance and things like that, or how important it is to just listen and be captivated by the story.
Well, I guess, I'm sorry, I missed the first question a little bit, but on the second one, it's a super interesting point, right? Like, what do people grab hold of, and what comes out of it, and what kind of, yeah, conversations does it elicit? And the way I work, and I think Rosie is super similar, but in a very different medium, is that there is this a kind of gift, I suppose, that's made to the audience of like, here's a lot of stuff that I'm interested in. There's a lot of constellations of things happening here. And part of that work, and it's interesting because it resonates with some of Boal's writing about people's theatre, is that how it's interpreted and how it's engaged with is in itself part of the performance, right? And that develops the work too. It can, or I'm comfortable rather with it operating in many spheres at the same time, and allowing for some of those connections to be explicit and stated, and some of them to be kind of gleaned days later or to come out in conversations later, or to just be in play somehow materially, even if they're not addressed kind of head on. And that's part of the work. I think that's a part of the making of it.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing, is when you use pop culture, you kind of are opening up that space for the audience's interpretation, the audience's memories of those characters, the audience's own experience of that more mainstream popular culture character, or that piece of music, or that TV show, or whatever, like all of those to kind of be activated in their mind. So I'm quite happy for something to trigger something, and then someone starts thinking about something. I think that for me, like, the way I attempt to use popular culture is to use it as a hook, right? To use it as a hook to get in, like, to try and break down, you know, performance art is a very, like, strange and elite form of art, you know, like, lots of people don't know where to experience it. Lots of people don't get to experience it. It feels very rarefied. There's a lot of like very complicated things written about it, and it's inaccessible. So to like put something in there as a hook, like, you know this, you know Moira. You know, no one can tell you about Moira. You know, you have your own relationship with her, and no one can take that away. So, and that trying to bring that in, it is always going to be, that is a gesture of relinquishing of control over the narrative.
I think there's also something super interesting in the idea of, this is a very loaded term, but in sampling. And I have to say, I don't fully, this is something that I'm just kind of coming to, so I need to get to grips with it more. But one thing when I was going through this process of first writing with Tribe Called Quest lyrics, and then now trying to work with clips of the sound themselves. It was such a fascinating process, because I realized like how multi-layered the sound is, in terms of like multiple voices happening at the same time, often overlays of voices, but also little tricks like I think they're called sonic signatures, where like a sound will come in that tells you to listen to the next bit, or that kind of alerts you that something is coming. So I think there's something super interesting that happens there in this idea of multiple layers being at play at one time, and the way in which you absorb that, even if it's not necessarily conscious and as incisive as we typically think of kind of scholarly academic production. So it was a super interesting process with Quest, because I was like, oh, that, like, I knew that was there, but I didn't know it was there. And similarly in the footage, and like in this process of drawing, that like part of the act of engaging with it, rehearsing with it, working with it, allows for these layers to be teased out, requires these layers to be teased out.
Yeah, I think my question came from, I think sometimes in architecture, especially, we want everyone to understand like every step of the process and all of the kind of different ideas embedded in the work, which sometimes kills its magic. I think it's really important that everyone can also read their own story into it or make their own connections. And that's what I found so amazing about listening to both of you present, is that there was just so much more that I like still need to think through and probably reflect on over many days, weeks, months to come, which is really exciting. And I think the sign of like really incredible and important projects is that when you don't fully understand them completely and and need to unpack like all the other things that you're projecting onto them as well as that informed their making. We've got one more question that's been, we've got a few more questions now posted in the chat. Spoke too soon. So the first is from Ella, who wanted to know if either of you have thoughts on the idea of performative roles within the pedagogy of art and architecture, and if that's something that resonates with you.
Could you elaborate, please, Ella? That's okay. Like, maybe verbally.
She might have an issue with her sound because she did ask if I could. I asked if she wanted to ask it, and she said she asked it.
Oh, okay. Sorry. I just wanted to like understand more the question.
Maybe it's coming in the chat.
Yes, maybe it is. Sorry, Thandi, unless you want to have a go. Yeah.
I'll dive in. if my reading of the question is correct, one thing that I have been thinking about a lot since that we're in this completely surreal moment in which almost every architecture school has suddenly discovered that Black Lives Matter and is having these like amazing lecture series with Black voices who previously they couldn't find them. I don't know where they are. our Dean Adrian has this really great take on it that like, yeah, it's really quite an amazing moment that these voices are suddenly within like architecture schools, and students are getting to engage with people who look like them, who come from completely different backgrounds than they would have normally, who are bringing completely different ideas around practice. And that in itself is quite special. At the same time, I've become, and I was super aware of this, particularly around when the Black Lives Matter protests were on the streets in London, around the ways in which particularly Black women get used and made to perform in particular ways in relation to institutions. And so I'm thinking of that particularly in myself and trying to be really careful about the things that I say yes to, the context in which my writing appears and in which my work appears, and understanding that that is super important. Because if for the project to have resonance, significance, to do the work that you want it to do, it can't be superficial. It needs to be engaged with seriously. It needs to have support for it. It needs to be able to do that work.
I don't have an elaboration yet, but I don't know.
Okay, don't worry.
If you want to say anything about that, otherwise there's another question that I can.
I agree with Thandi.
Akhil has asked a question from the Resolve fam, and says, such an amazing talk as always, both. Maybe this is something you can shed light on for all the students and budding artist practitioners in the audience. What were some of the most important moments in your respective performative practices that were formed at times when you yourselves were part of the or a audience?
A great question, one that I'm definitely going to have to take away and think on for a lot longer. But the one that comes to the top of my mind is seeing DJ Lene Denise speak about her work on DJ scholarship. And like this was not a talk. This is like a full-bodied, like incredible performance with decks, and which required of us as an audience to like meet her in the place that she was at in sharing this work.
And I say that and like meet her in terms of energy levels, but also kind of do this work of thinking with her while she played music, but also then reflected on it and giving her kind of feedback and a call and response that you would typically associate with like a live musical performance. And for me, thinking of scholarship in that way was just like transformative. If our pedagogic spaces can have the same energy as those kinds of spaces, the same performative nature as those kinds of spaces, which we know, as Rosa has said, to be so informed by Black culture, then that's incredible. But also vice versa, it requires of us to do that work, again, as Rosa said, of thinking of those performance spaces, spaces of performance of popular culture as pedagogic spaces too, right? It works both ways.
I think that's a really difficult question, but it's like making me think loads. The thing is that the examples I think of are performances where I was asked to participate, as in like as an audience member, like you had to in order to experience the work. So I was thinking like really early on, like when I was still working in architecture, I was going to twerk shops by Fanny Sosa, where she'd encourage, where you could go along and learn to twerk with Fanny, but also they were talking about how certain ways in which it was a process of unlearning and certain postures that they posited as colonial and restrictive, and instead like learning to know one's body and to hold one's body in a different way, which had a different history. And that was really transformative to my way of thinking, because I don't think I'd really thought before about the ways in which our posture and literally, like thinking literally about how colonialism has impacted the way we can move through space, the way we can feel comfortable, as in slouching or back straight or the ways in which we can let go, like how that really manifests in our bodies, like colonialism, which is a spatial concern maybe, and yeah, also manifests in our bodies still today. So I think that was really amazing, and Sosa makes amazing work still to this today.
I guess Ella has posted in the chat to say that Thandi responded to the impulse of my question perfectly, but I suppose I wondered whether art and architecture pedagogy demands or inflicts a certain type of performance. And she said that maybe that's a leading question, but she was thinking about the noise that institutions are making in the face of calls for decolonizing the curriculum, where performance might be problematic or generative.
Yeah, I think I think me and Thandi talk a lot about this, about unnecessary noise. But yeah, I don't really know what to say about it, I guess. As in, I think that I get from your sense of your question that people may be already on the same page.
Yeah, maybe to tie this one with Akhil's question previously about this idea of, I mean, picking up on something in his question about the idea of audience and things we've talked about today in general about kind of who's performing for who and who are performances for. Maybe to end, it would be interesting for you both to reflect on kind of when making work, like who are you thinking of as the audience? Is it yourself? Is it a particular group of people? Is it years from now for people to look back on a very different type of archive?
I think I make performance for myself.
I think it's important, like, first and foremost, for me to do that. I think performance as me has been a type of therapy, a type of, like, yeah, reconnecting with myself, taking hold of the means of production, if not just for a few minutes. And I think that, I hope that if I do that thoroughly enough, that my work will resonate with other people. I think for me, that's the work that I see that is the most personal and is the most interrogating of that, of the self, and really does, is trying to do work that the artist is so invested in. That's the work that I get the most from as an audience member. So that's what I try to do in my own work too. So I don't think it's necessary, although it is, I guess, in some ways quite selfish. I do think that, like kind of like we've been saying, like, to pay attention to oneself as a Black woman seriously is very radical and often and can have a lot of power beyond the individual.
Yeah, I mean, that's so beautiful, Rosa. And I think I'm doing something similar. I'm making the only kind of work that I can make, really. because we live in a particular kind of condition of, like, hugely vampiric racial capitalism. And if your work is not engaging with that, if it's not contending with that, then you're making incomplete work. And so I make this work and I hope that it encourages and inspires others to take that up too. Because I think, my God, it's so urgent. We just have to.
Well, I think we began with your call to arms in the lecture description, and I think we'll end with this: make work for yourself and engage with these issues that really matter, because you have to. So thank you so much, both of you, for a really, really inspiring evening. I could probably keep going, but I know we have to end because Thandi has another event to go to.
Please come.
But in order to give you a semblance of what a real event would be, I'm going to try and mass unmute everyone so that you can get a round of applause or what's possible on Zoom. Thank you.
Thank you.